is holy. Holy is the Lord. Oh, holy is the Lord. Holy is the Lord. Heaven and earth now sing. Heaven and earth now sing. Heaven and earth now sing. Heaven and earth now see your praise. It's holy is the Lord. Oh, holy is the Lord. It's holy is the Holy is the Lord. Yes, holy is the Lord. Holy is the Lord. Sing all ye heavens, sing. Stars both near and far, sing it out, bring your best, glorify, 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 glorify. Lord, you are worthy of all praise. Lord, you are worthy of all praise. Let the praises ring out. Let them ring out. Let them ring out. The praises ring out loud. Oh, let the praises ring out loud. Oh, let the praises.
With them. give you praise. We give you praise, Lord. We lift up our voices.
You're my salvation.
Salvation. a strength to those secure who you are. You are Lord. Lord, you are ever faithful. You are always sure.
A helper to the helpless. A strength to those secure who you are.
Sovereign is your name. The wonders of the universe declare your mighty faith, Lord Jesus. You're my salvation. But you're my salvation. But you're my salvation. Jehovah's salvation. You're my salvation. You're my salvation. But you're my entrance towards heaven. Begin to praise Him now. Stretch out your hands towards heaven. Lord, we stretch our hands out towards You, oh God. Your glory now. Lord, Your glory now. Your mighty presence, Father. Your glory. Your glory. Your glory now. Father, let Your glory overwhelm our lives. Let Your glory overwhelm this place. Holy Spirit. Lord, shake the foundations of our lives. Shape the foundation of our lives. Shake this place, oh God, we pray. Shape this place, oh God, in Jesus' name. You, oh God, and You alone. You, oh God, and You alone. Gird Your sword upon Your side. Come ride prosperously, oh God. Gird Your sword upon Your side. Come ride prosperously, oh God. Let all men see now the glorified Jesus. Be glorified. Be glorified. Gamana say it, he can't got your coin in him at a. Says it in an umbra. Kuramamanegas. Tonight, just look at yourself as God's cure, God's remedy, those who stand between the living and the dead. Just go ahead and begin to offer up a praise, an offering of sacrifice, a sweet smell by the Holy Ghost. Let God begin to change things through your prayers. Let God begin to change things through your lives. Let the Spirit of the Lord overwhelm you, flood out of you like rivers. Tonight I pray in Jesus' name that you will not only see that you have been given the authority in Christ Jesus, but also the responsibility for every human being alive. Just lift your hands and cry, oh God, flow out of me like rivers. Flow out of me.
Flow out of me.
Like rivers.
Like rivers.
Sovereign is Your name. Worship you in the Spirit, in the Holy Spirit that you've given us. We worship you, Father God, with all our hearts. Will everybody shout, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Take control, Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Take full control, Holy Spirit. Take full control, Holy Spirit.
Take full control, Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah. Come glorify Jesus.
Glorify Jesus.
Come reveal him.
Come reveal him.
In all of his power.
All of his power.
All of his splendor.
All of his splendor.
All of his glory.
All of his glory.
Through me. Because I'm going to just tell you right now, by and large, he's not going to do it absent of you and I. He's not going to do it absent of us. That's why he gave us the river tonight. We want everybody to be in expectation that what Jesus proclaimed in John chapter 7, verse 38, we're not going to be telling you here tonight anything other than what Jesus Christ preached, what the Holy Ghost revealed to his apostles and holy prophets. And all you got to do is begin to move with the Word of God. Don't draw back. Don't be reluctant. Don't be suspicious or critical, or don't be anything other than hungry and thirsty. And what's going to happen is the Word of God is going to produce faith on the inside of you, and an explosion of heaven will take place. And no one will recognize you tomorrow. You won't recognize yourself. I love it. You know, God does such supernatural works without us that the psalmist said, I will awaken with your likeness. I mean, he'd do it in your sleep. Woo! In fact, I think sometimes the Lord gets more done that way. Father, we thank you that there will be nothing in our lives that would resist you. There'd be nothing tonight in our hearts, oh God. They would be reluctant to conform to you.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Father, we thank you for this wonderful work of grace, this glorious realm called the anointing of the Holy Ghost, this endowment of power from on high, that we can be what you proclaimed for us, what you commanded us to be. Father, that which you decreed.
Father, that which you've decreed, we demand. Father, that which you've decreed of our lives, we demand it. Father, you decreed all your glory, all your beauty, all your splendor, all your authority, all your power to do these things that only you can do. Hallelujah. 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 Will everybody just greet and welcome Pat Schatzline? Come. Pat, come up here. Come up here and take over and then for a while. And then.
Come on, give my God a praise. Give my God a praise. Come on, let's give him a praise. You're not done. Let's praise him. Hey! In the middle of worship a moment ago, I had a vision of Dagon falling in the middle of the night. As the glory of the Lord was in the temple, they brought the presence of God in. Remember what happened? They brought the ark in, and they all get up the next morning with hemorrhoids. The Spirit of the Lord, so hits this demonic statue that represented the death of children, really, I think. And his hands and his head broke off. And I said, Lord, why did you just show me that? Right in the middle of worship, he said, because there are those that have been trying to steal my presence, and I'm going to shock them back into my back into my power. He said, because they're trying to do it through worship and raising a Saul generation that loves worship more than word because it soothes their demons. And what you got to understand is the Lord, right during worship, I saw Dagon falling, and I said, Lord, why did you just show me that? He said, because it's worship like this that will begin to break out as the remnant is rising, and the things that have been exalting itself higher than God, humanism, all the other stuff, it's going to fall. And the Lord is resurrecting. God is resurrecting. It is time to restore the headless bride. Are you with me? She may look good, but she don't have any brains. And God is looking for a bride that knows who he is. He is the head of the church. He is Jesus. He is King. He is Lord. Come on and praise him. Jesus! I'm telling you, the spirit of Yahweh, Elohim, I am, the spirit of the sovereign Lord is upon me. He has anointed me to preach good news to the poor, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom to the captives. I believe this with all my heart. As you were worshiping tonight, it was hitting I-15, and it was just messing people up. And they're just driving along, and God is just invading cars and breathing on them. It is time for us to rise up. You know, for so long, the world has been brash and we've been bashful. And God says, I'm looking for a people that will proclaim me even if they get arrows. How many of you know arrows can't touch you? They get sent to the ground. And tonight, in just a moment, can I show you something for just a second? Since last time we were here, and let me just say this. I'm at home. I have never been more in love. Karen, come here. Come here, baby. I brought my gift from heaven, 25 years, and I'm telling you, it don't matter. It don't matter if you're ugly as long as you're anointed, amen? God takes care of a brother. Some of you boys need to pray. Wasn't this worship unbelievable from the Lord? Didn't you just, but I wanted Karen to greet you real quick because these two people over here have just become a gift to us. And Pastor Mark and Pastor Ann are gifts from God to this body and to us. Like no one we've ever met before. a radical shift, transition. And then when I was here, it's been almost a year that we met in Washington, D.C., and then it's here in October, and we saw God do good stuff. But I'm not even the same guy since then. But you're going to hear from this prophetess tomorrow night. But I wanted you to just hear her voice real quick. Karen, would you greet everybody?
I'm just so honored to be here. Since I have been here, I want you to know I have never been in a place where I feel the presence of God so strong. Since we have been with y'all, we have been challenged to stir, just to go to such a deeper level. You don't realize what you have here. This is true religion. This is a true relationship with God. This is true, what I would say, this is where revival begins. And I am excited to be a part of it.
Let's tell them what God is doing. Pastor Mark asked me to share what God's doing. We were just in, since January 1, we've seen about 25,000 come to Christ. Those are real numbers. Those aren't made up evangelistic numbers. Isn't that cool? Isn't what God's doing is so cool? Last week alone, people coming up to us at the end of the services, young people that cut themselves, their scars disappear right in the middle of the services, because when the love of the Father enters in, he not only heals the inside, he transforms the outside. And a scar means you're only 80% healed, and God knows how to do a complete work. And we've seen all these moves of God, and we were just in Pennsylvania at the Giant Center in Pennsylvania, where there was about 8,000 students, and it was so cool because I love it when union people that are in charge of security get messed up. They're weeping, and all of a sudden in the middle of the sermon, kids are running past them, and they're supposed to stop them, but they can't because those kids got it. One little girl, probably 13 years old, comes running down. This big, huge union guy tries to stop her because I'm up preaching, and she just shoved his hand and fell on her face and began to cry out to God. There comes a moment where there's an awakening, and I'm reminded of about 2 months ago, I was on stage, and I'm in the middle of the altar call, and they're wailing and they're crying out. Do you have that? Scott, can you play that video, the Pennsylvania video? It's just so cool because I just wanted you to see this, because I used my camera to film it, and I don't even know how to do it right. My tech people tell me I have no concept of what I'm doing. Do you have the video of it, though? Do you have the video? That's it. That's it right there. But there's a video. I don't know if you have that video, but it's cool. If you don't have it, that's cool. That's it right there. That's God breaking out in Pennsylvania at a remnant. God's raising up the remnant. Are you with me so far? And what you got to understand is tonight, in just a moment, you're going to sow into this vision. It's a pure vision. Pastor Mark is on our board of directors. He gets the finances of this vision, and it's a ministry that is called to shake the nations. And recently, one night, I'm sound asleep, and I always say this, I have a sleep disorder called Revelation, and so does Karen. Karen just wrote about it in her new book. That you ready? You got it? I can't tell if you got it or not. And if you don't, okay, yeah, let's show it. Show them that video. This is just a few students crying out to God. No, that's not it. Wrong video. Don't worry about it. That's the one we're going to show before I preach. Don't worry about it. But what you got to understand is God is doing something so big, and he's awakening his bride. And, you know, we always say that it's going to be through young people. I really think that's rude. I do. I think it's rude. Yeah, we love their energy and their passion, but I believe the remnant is all ages, 8 and 80 years old. And the stirring that is happening, and I was asleep one night, and I was sound asleep, and I'm like almost over a city, and I'm looking down on this massive metropolis, and I see people running, like the running of the bulls or something, and I see them running, and I said, Lord, what is that? And he said, that's them running. That's the remnant coming together. And it's going to happen across this nation, the outbreak of God. And the Bible says in Psalms, when you go out sowing precious seed, weeping and sowing precious seed, you're going to bring back the sheaves. You are a part of that. This is a house that is transforming the nations. This is a house that will be pointed out on I believe, at Bema's seat. They'll go, hey, where's abundant life? Where's abiding place at? We want to see where abiding place is, because there's an anointing, and y'all got abundant life, so... But I just want to say this. We're getting ready, and we start next January launching again into cities to see the outpouring of God. And the enemy is attacking. Even this morning, a crazy attack came. But I believe that we're about to see the supernatural. So tonight, if you want to sow into this vision and help this vision go forth, be a part of it. I believe it's massive, and we hear crazy reports of what God is doing when people sow into this vision. Pastor, come on. Do we have the video? Do you have? Oh, yeah, there it is. That's the video. That's it. Show this. Well, just watch this. This is cool. Watch it. Make sure you turn up the sound. Okay, the sound's not up. You may want to start it over. This is just too cool, because I handed them the microphone to a teenage girl, and I said, pray over your generation. And you can hear her screaming, God, rescue the Joshua generation. It's just really cool. But that's it. It's starting. I feel it. I feel it. If we're not good to go, that's okay. My team has actually got the lead. There it is. Start over.
You are a Joshua.
Go ahead. This is me with my phone on stage doing this. Okay, that's perfect. Anybody ready to sow into this vision? That's what's going to happen across the nations. We're going to see an awakening. You are a part of it. You know what's cool? Is he's going to be right there with me. We're going to do this together. I really believe that this vision that is here is going to break out, and you guys are going to be a part of this. We're going to go into cities. I believe God's called us to march this thing out. I believe God's called us to walk in and shake cities on every campus. We're going to see churches that have been dead for years suddenly alive again. God's going to birth forth fire on Sunday mornings. I'm going to start prophesying for a second and tell you that what we have seen is nothing. We are stepping into the last great awakening. The wave is coming of his glory, and it's going to hit cities. And God is walking by on Sunday mornings right now. He spoke this to me. He said, I'm walking by on Sunday mornings, and I'm peeking into the doors of churches, and if they do not acknowledge me, I will keep walking. And what you got to realize is God says, I'm looking for the righteous to rise up, to be bold as lions, and be those that will stand and roar and will declare that he is king. And this awakening is coming, so you need to get ready for it. And it is big and it is massive. And the seed of revival is sitting right in this house right here. Are you with me? Come on, give the Lord a praise offering. Pastor.
Wow. Well, I'm going to be ever so brief here. I just want you to understand that the government of the United States of America did not birth the move of God in the United States of America, but the move of God birthed the United States government in America. And here we are in election year, and people have got all these various different hopes and dreams that they're trying to put in a new candidate, and then everybody got all these various different fears and concern about all the things that these giants, these powerhouses for the realms of the demonic are doing. And then we cower and hide behind caves, or in caves and behind rocks, and act like we don't have the authority to change everything. I'm going to tell you right now, Father's called you and I to come sow our life like a seed into the ground. He said it will produce much fruit. And, of course, we know when the Lord Jesus made that statement in John chapter 12 and verse 24, the context was about him reproducing his life in us. And then he hits the point once again. Right after that verse, in verse 29, he says, you got to lose your life too. And so tonight, people, we are hooked up with what Pat and Karen Schatzline is doing, because we recognize there are not a lot of people that are running with the purposes of God and cultivating what is absolutely essential to see this nation and every nation shaped and changed by the power of God. And I want you to understand this. Listen, I look at certain people, and I love everything that God is doing, but there's some folks that are just running over here with a great, you know, anointing of the Holy Ghost, but no call to consecration and holiness. They don't have any understanding of what it means to live sanctified lives. It's almost a lost doctrine to the church. Then on the other side, you got people who are willing to some degree be a call to the people of God to come over here and stand on the other side, but yet there is not that force of the signs and wonders anointing of the Lord Jesus Christ. We have to return to the moving of the Holy Spirit that Jesus described in John chapter 14 and verse 20, when he said, in that day, at that time, when you begin to move in the Holy Ghost, you'll know the Father is in me, that I'm in you, and that you are in me. We have to understand that only the Pentecost that Jesus talked about when he said, John baptized with water, but you'll be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days from now, is the essential means. Listen, I want you to hear this just before you come and sow your life. I don't want anybody giving an offering that does not look like you're sowing your life, okay? I want it needs to be consecrated seed, precious seed. It needs to be something like on the level of that which is sacred. It has to be something on the level of that which is the very best, because I'm telling you, Father is not going to leave you absent of the multiplication factor that he promised. He's absolutely faithful concerning these things. He's looking for some people that he can raise up and trust with true riches. And I'm going to tell you right now, I'm number one in line, and you're going to have to really work hard to shove
grab me out of the queue, because, and I hope that you do. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ, you get so radical about this, because I'm going to tell you, if Satan's agenda was able to be advanced and that which men are doing was able to be successful, you and I would not have, or enjoy any of the freedoms by and large and the blessings that we've come so easily to take for granted and call common. They not. And we're going to press in for it. And we know the remedy and we know the cure. It is the power and the authority of the name of Jesus and of the blood of Jesus and of the work of the Holy Ghost. We don't have any trust in how much money we have in the bank account, how much our job can supply to us, how much we can predict we can get next year. We see nothing but the divine provision of unlimited miracle grace that has been given to those who are going to stand up and run this race. Hallelujah. Okay? So having said that, come give. Come worship. Blessed is the name of the... Everybody come worship. Everybody just... Listen, if you're writing out a check... Listen, let me say this. Put it up here. If you're writing out a check, make out your checks to APM or Abiding Place Ministry. We promise you. Listen, some of you aren't moving. You're not going to get much till you learn how to give much. I'm going to tell you right now. I'm going to tell you, one of the characteristics of revival is the realms of people giving and sowing their lives. And maybe you don't even know how to do that yet. But just keep coming back and keep coming back to every meeting. And I'm going to tell you, Father's going to show you how to follow the Lord Jesus, take up your cross, and with total abandonment serve Him. But listen, tonight I don't want anybody left out. Somebody say, well, what's your plea about? My plea is about you having a genuine encounter with God that produces the life and miracle ministry of the Holy Spirit in your life. I know what you're going to have. I know the simple steps and acts of obedience. We don't want anyone left out. I want everybody to stand with me once again. You sat down too quickly. You pinched your wallet between you and your seat. I want you to feel this. I know that this place, I know this church is the most giving church. I understand that. But I want you to hook up with me tonight. I just feel this special thing in God for miracles tonight. I want you to hook up with me tonight for a miracle in the realm of the financial provision that Father wants to release into your life. I know these things have been said over and again, and much of it has been abused so that people have just become almost numb to this plea of the Holy Ghost. But I'm telling you, it's different here. There is a miracle thing going on. We want to hook up with what Pat and what Karen are doing, both in especially within the framework of, you know, the remnant movement. And so I want everybody to be a part of this. I want you to be a part of it every night. I want you to be willing and ready to give with total abandonment every night. Let me just tell you how it goes. This is how it goes down. I'm going to share this, and then I'm going to hand this back to Pat. There were nights over and again, because from about 1995 to the year 2001, we ran with revival in the city, bringing people in from all over the world. And there would be sometimes anywhere from 1,000 to 2,000 people in the meeting. And you know what? If the Abiding Place people were here, the core people of the Abiding Place were in the meeting, the offering was exactly the same as the offering if there was 2,000 people in the meeting. And it really always concerned me, because I pretty much had a baseline as to what the Abiding Place people were going to give. And I want to remind you of the things that Father has done through your life. I want you to step up with me here, and I want you to push through this realm, because I understand what happens when we begin to participate with God beyond ourselves, beyond the limits that we've confined ourselves, whether it's financially or whether it's gifting, whatever. When we push ourselves beyond that limit, a breakthrough, a miraculous breakthrough comes, because Father, from the very beginning, is just calling us to come into a relationship with Him where we trust Him with total abandonment. I want you to wake up in the morning like Abraham. I want you to take the donkey, saddle the donkey with the wood, grab the fire and the sacrifice, and just run to Moriah. I mean, just run to the altar, okay? Run. And listen, there is a place where we are cultivating something in God. We see Pat and Karen cultivating this on a platform that God has given them that is bigger than any of us have. We get the privilege of participating with that through our giving. giving. I'm going to tell you, money makes a terrible master and it's a kind of good servant. So you take all of that and you turn everything that you have within respect to those realms of the finances, okay, into servants. But I don't want you to stop short of there. I want you to get a hold of everything that you have in God, and I want to see it. I want you to bring it to bear. I want you to stand up and shout, and I want you to stand up and worship God. I want you to stand up and flow in the anointing. Listen to me. I want you to hook up with us in a realm that will take you to another place of receptivity in God. Listen, I know how these things work. As soon as there begins to be a whirlwind of the moving of the Spirit of the Lord, Satan attacks people right, left, and center, and they do not know how to utilize the shield of faith. They don't know how to stand in the realm of the anointing. And so, ultimately, he's able to effectively scatter the things that God is doing. I want you to move in close and get louder. In Jesus' name.
Come on and praise him! Hey! Sondere bebebe ke sete. I hear a shofar going off in the spirit right now. I am telling you, I am so stirred. You might be seated across this house if you can't. If you can't sit down, the altar area is open from this point on. And if at any given point the Spirit of God hits you, there is a spiritual line that you will cross tonight in this service. There's going to be a line that the minute you step over, it's in a spiritual imaginary line that God already drew before you ever built it or bought this building. You need to understand, long before they built this building for people to learn how to fly, God had already prepared this house, because God always covers the land before the people build on it. And you got to understand, he was standing here long before we were. He said, they will come and stand on the corner of I-15 and praise me. And there's an awakening spirit over this house. And I'm so excited. I'm so stirred. I don't know what God's going to do. If I stop preaching at one point and just go to the altar, be ready. Because there's a prophetic mantle here. And there's a very stirring mantle on my heart right now. Can I preach tonight? Is that okay? Can we have fun? Come on, give him one more praise. My goodness, I feel his presence. I'm really excited. About 2 weeks ago, I launched another book. It was a follow-up to I Am Remnant. It's called Unqualified. Because the Lord spoke to me, and it's a whole prophetic word I'll probably share it on Sunday morning, that I was driving down the road, and I'd been on the phone with Rodney Howard Brown and some other key leaders, and we were praying over something, and God began to speak to me, and I pulled into our post office to check the ministry mailbox. And I'm sitting there, and all of a sudden, the Spirit of the Lord says, get your phone out. And I begin to write out this prophetic word. And God, he says, Pat, I'm about to use the unqualified across America to awaken those that have been so stooped in their self-built kingdoms. He said, I'm about to embarrass them. And out of that, God birthed this brand new book. And the opening chapter is called Ah, Sovereign Lord. Because he kept saying that to me 1 year ago when we were in D.C. I woke up actually a few days right before we left. I kept hearing, Ah, Sovereign Lord, Ah, Sovereign Lord. I'm like, Lord, why do I keep hearing that? I don't understand why I keep hearing it. Then I began to study it. The Ah is a holy cry. It's a crying out. And Sovereign Lord is the holy name of God. It means he is in charge. It means he doesn't need Congress. It means it doesn't matter what's going on in the government. It doesn't matter what's going on in the economic system of this world. Are you getting this so far? I'm talking about the understanding that God is in charge. When you get a true revelation of God being in charge, it shifts the way you think. There is no room for worry. There is no room for fear. There is no room for any of those things that try to hold you back. Are you getting this so far? And so then the book goes into years of me feeling unqualified, preaching to thousands, and would go home and feel like a failure. And it was a lying spirit that had been my family. I love what Spurgeon said. Sooner or later, every man's got to face his daddy's demons. And there comes a point where you have to conquer the things that have been in your family. Are you with me? You have to say, wait a minute, enough of that. I said it to my mom last night on the phone. I had a cousin get killed running from the cops, got shot by the cops a couple days ago. And she said, you know, my mom calls me last night. I was with Pastor Mark. And all of a sudden I said, but mom, we've broken that curse. That's not us anymore. And there comes a moment where you take authority over what continually tries to come to your front door. Are you with me? Now, there's and the reason why I wrote the book Unqualified, because from cover to cover, God used unqualified remnants. Nobodies. He would go and say, you know what? These seven brothers, they don't have it. But is there anybody else? Well, there's this kid. He's out in the field somewhere. But he knows how to kill the lion and the bear. The lion's the thing that pounces on you like insecurity or fear, and the bear's the thing that hibernates in your life and only comes out when it's hungry, and you don't wrestle with it. You got to play dead to it. It's the only way to defeat the bear. And then God lets you have the giant. And there comes a moment where God raises up the unqualified. Then it goes into, so many people think they're plan B. Let me just tell you something. You will see over the next year, major, major, major failures begin to take place. But it's not because the church is being embarrassed. It's because God's not putting up with sin anymore. I believe this with all my heart. You're going to see people fall. I write about all that. If you haven't got Unqualified or I haven't got Iron Remnant first, the first book, actually the first book's Why Is God So Mad at Me? How many of you know he's not mad at you, he's mad about you? Breaks that lying spirit off of you. It's level one, level two, level three. Level four is going to be called Let Them Eat Cake. You don't even want to hear about that one. Secular Christianity. You know what I love about being here? Everything. You know, I started to say some stuff, but it's just like everything. And so grab your Bibles tonight. Get ready, because God's going to show you tonight that in your darkest moment, before you knew him, he knew you. What I have learned about the darkness is if you'll turn the light on, you'll find treasures. And what you got to understand is, as I get ready to move into this word, and you don't want to miss tomorrow night, because there's this crazy hot chick that's speaking that just is going to mess you up. I'm telling you, you just need to be ready for that. But so I'm kind of her commercial tonight. But I do want to say quickly, because I just believe that honor opens doorways over your own life. It rolls out red carpets. And I want to say to Pastor, thanks. Thanks for coming into my life. Thanks for being my friend. Thanks for being the real deal. I honor you deeply. We are brothers. And for life. And I do want to stop prophetically for just a second, because I just can't stop doing this. And I felt it just a moment ago. And oh, by the way, my beautiful daughter, Abby, is here. I need to do that. Abby, would you stand up real quick or just lean? This is Abigail. And since last time I was here, I became a grandfather. I know, shocking, because I'm 24. But little Jack was born. My son is youth pastor up in Modesto, California. He and Adrian, and little Jack was born. You'll see him in the NFL, so just get ready. And you think I'm joking? I had a vision of that, and so we're already stretching his arm. Nate told me, he said, "Dad, I'm gonna get him signed up for football camp at 3 months." But I must go prophetic for just a moment, because I can't get rid of it. And then I'll preach the word. Because I'm going to go to 1 Samuel, the 3rd chapter, in a moment. Because God is awakening the Samuels. And I was out worshiping one day. And I was out jogging, actually. I don't really jog, but I loiter. And I'm just out praising God on the corner one day. And all of a sudden, the Spirit of the Lord says to me, I'm going to awaken the Samuels. Now, what you got to realize is, as I begin to study that, let me go back prophetic for just a minute. Daniel, would you stand up for just a second? I can't get rid of this. I can't get rid of this. I can't get rid of this. The Spirit of the Lord has said that he has never allowed you to fit in. He's never allowed you. He's allowed you to be in the room, but not in the room. He's allowed you to be a part of great influence, but at the same time, he did not allow others to influence you. And he said, "Son, I have chose you as a John the Baptist, one that will stand on the tree stumps in the forest, and I will bring those to you." He said, "I have chosen you to lead a movement in this generation. I have chosen you to carry my sword of the Spirit into the other realms that others have never seen before." He said, "I have put something inside of you that you cannot handle seeing fakeness. You cannot handle seeing guile in people. And because of that, he is entrusting you with a new mantle, a new season. Something is going to begin to break out." And the Lord is unrolling a scroll that was dusty that he has tried to hand to others many times, but now he's handing to you. And he says, "Son, in the scroll, I have prophesied your future. I have declared what you will do. And it will go down in the history books that you will lead a movement. And the movement will be of the righteous. It will be a movement of those that he has separated, those that have been abandoned, those that had been wounded, and those that have been hurt." He said, "I have given you a compassion for those that others do not have." He said, "I've given you a true compassion that comes from the heart of God." And he says, "I've chosen you." And he said, "You need to know that there's going to begin to times. He said, many times you're going to be getting calls to be a part of things, and I will tell you no. You will see a neon sign in the spirit that says no. But other times you'll see a yes. And God says, when you go, you will invade places, and you will walk into places meek as a dove, but as shrewd as a serpent, with the anointing of the Lord to be able to declare things that others could not speak and break off. You have been handpicked by the Lord as a prophet to this generation, and you are to rise up and step into that and never take yourself as one that is plan B or one that is second or one that must sit and wait. God says, now is your moment. Do you believe that from the Lord? Amen. See, I said it last time I was here, that my anointing is to preach to the cave dwellers. And I have learned you can only preach where you've survived. Don't tell me theory, show me scars. Are you with me? And what you got to understand is, I love 1 John 3:20. It says, if our hearts condemn us, we know that God is greater than our hearts and he knows everything. I've come to talk to everybody that has been waiting. Ha ha. You're the remnant. Romans 11 verse 5. So too at the present time there's a remnant chosen by grace. And just as the prophet thought, it goes on to say, that he was the only one, yet God had reserved for himself 7,000. You have to understand, God has reserved this house for right now. And there's another wave that is coming. The same wave that hit in 1995 or 94, 95, whenever it was. It is coming back to this building. And you have to understand, you're not a bunch of just crazy dreamers. Now, I understand if you tell the wrong people, you get your dreams, you get thrown in the pit, Joseph. But I also realize that if you learn to flee and leave your coat on the bedpost and walk away from the wife of some evil man, God will protect you and restore the dreams. So I've got to preach this tonight because it's burning in my spirit. He said, I'm going to awaken Samuels in this room. I've come to talk to the ones that are peripheral. That God's been saying, what is your deal? When is your moment? And God says it's now. I don't know about you. Have you ever been woke up in the middle of the night? Now, I've had crazy stuff happen to me. About 2.5 years ago, I was in El Salvador preaching, and all of a sudden, I'm sound asleep, and next thing I know, MS-13 gangs and MS-14 gangs are outside fighting outside my window, and I'm underneath the bed as bullets are going off. And I do believe that I was praying in the spirit. I might have gone to the bathroom, too. I don't know. And so I've had crazy stuff happen. At one point, we had a demon-possessed Yorkie. Her nickname was Legion. And the times where in the middle of the night, she would just decide to fall down the stairs. And we'd hear it, middle of the night. We have wooden stairs in our house. And then she'd just get up and go, and shake it off. Have you ever had crazy stuff happen? The time where about 1.5, 2 years ago, I was sound asleep, and I'm laying next to Karen in the Love Palace, and all of a sudden in my sleep, true story, can't prove it, in my sleep, I'm fighting ninjas, which is Muslims, biblical, and I really am, and I'm winning, and I never win in my dreams. And I had clothes on. It was awesome. And I'm fighting. True story. I'm fighting and I went, wada! And then I was laying next to Karen. And all of a sudden, I get punched in the face. For real. And I sit up and I'm like, dear God, what? And she goes, don't you ever. I don't care if you're dreaming. Hit me. Because in my sleep, I had shabamo. And so I just rolled over and fell asleep, just kind of sucking my thumb. And or the time I was out of town speaking, and my son was in junior high, and he had about 4 or 5 little junior hires over at the house, and junior hires can scare each other. I mean, they can start freaking each other out. They're all up in his room. Karen's asleep downstairs, and all of a sudden they start scaring each other like, bro, did you hear that? Something's in the garage. It's Freddy. It's Jason. It's Chucky. That's a weird dude. And they get so weirded out that Nate runs into my prayer room where I have this machete that I got given to me on a mission trip. It's a weird story. And grabs the machete. He and his friends all run downstairs. Karen's sound asleep, and she opens her eyes because they're standing around the bed. And Nate's holding the machete like this. It's a Lifetime movie. And all of a sudden, Karen looks up and says, "Nate, what are you doing?" He goes, Mom, we heard something in the garage. We need you to go kill it." I was so proud of him. It's what I do when I hear something. I'm like, Karen, you go check. I'll call the police. I called him that afternoon. I said, "Way to be the man of the house there, big man." But you know what I've learned? I've learned you're always stronger or weak in your dreams. It just depends on what you've been watching before you fell asleep. And tonight I must preach for a few minutes about the awakening of the Samuels. I've heard the stories. I've spoke to over 2 million in this generation. The little girl that walked up to me last week in Georgia where I was speaking, and she said, "I was raped by my stepdad, and my mom lets her boyfriends come over and do things to me." She said, "But when you were preaching tonight, God began to heal me on the inside." Or a week ago Sunday in Toronto, Canada, when a man walked up to me and he said, "Until you preached today, I did not think of myself as a man. And God restored my gender tonight, today." See, I serve a God that suddenly knows how to interrupt the darkness. Now watch, because I'm preaching this and you got to get a hold of this. And I was out worshiping the Lord one day. And see, I've had prophetic dreams too. The dream I write about in I Am Remnant, when I'm sitting in front of this old radio and I'm turning the channels. And as I'm turning the channels and I'm sitting with key leaders from around America, and I believe you were there. And every time I would turn the channel, it would say, "Outbreak of God in Atlanta, Georgia. The remnant is worshiping." I turn it again, "Outbreak of God in Detroit, Michigan. Again, the remnant is worshiping." I turn it again, "Outbreak of God in Seattle. Outbreak of God in New York. Outbreak of God in Salt Lake. Outbreak of God in San Francisco. Outbreak of God in San Diego." And I began to weep and laugh so hard that I woke up and Karen looked over at me and she said, "What's wrong?" And the glory of the Lord filled our bedroom. And it was exactly midnight. We've been asleep for about 30 minutes. And I said, "It's coming to America, Karen. It's coming." And I jumped out of bed and I ran upstairs and emailed a dear father in my life named Reinhard Bunke. And I said, "Pastor, I just had a dream. It's coming. The move of God is coming to America." And he emailed me back and said, "I know." I'm always like second on the revelation list. I get it, just a little later than everybody else. And so you got to understand. And the Bible says this in 1 Samuel chapter 3. Are you ready? It says, "And the lamp of God had not yet gone out. And Samuel was lying down in the house of the Lord where the presence of God was." Well, the dream I had 2 years ago, it became reality when I'm laying in a hotel room. And all of a sudden, before I fell asleep, I said, "Lord, I always ask this, but I'd really like to see you tonight in my sleep." And at 1:30 in the morning, I began to scream and weep. And the fear of God entered the hotel room and the light and the glory of the Lord. And I knew he was in the room. And I began to scream, "Don't come any closer, Lord, or I'll die." I had never had the fear of the Lord. Listen, if you have fear of the Lord in your life, it will guard against all perversion, I'm telling you. It shifts the way you think. You're so guarded. And all of a sudden, the Lord said to me, "Pat, if you'll give me everything you have, I'll give you everything I have. If you'll tell a generation, if they'll give me everything they have." Some of you heard me tell this story, but he said, "Pat, if you'll tell a generation, if they'll give me everything they have, I'll give them everything I have." And I woke up and I began to read John chapter 7, ask, seek, and knock, perpetual verb. It means never stop asking, never stop seeking, never stop knocking. And I began to dance before the Lord till the early hours of the morning because of his glory. I saw literally the handprint. I saw his hand and his foot. I saw the nails, scars, and I began to worship. Worship him, begin to praise him. See, there's a moment when God interrupts your darkness. Are you still with me? Now jump over to verse 10 of 1 Samuel chapter 3, and I'll fill in the blanks in just a moment, because the Bible says in 1 Samuel chapter 3, verse 10, "And the Lord came and stood there, calling as at other times." Do you think that the first time you heard the word of the Lord, the voice of the Lord, it was the first time? Oh. He said, "Samuel, Samuel." Then Samuel said, "Speak." for your servant is listening. See, the enemy in the world loves to define you as an oops, an accident, a nobody. He loves to tell you who you are. The world loves to tell you from the moment you're born. He loves to put this identity thing on you and try to speak to who you are. But God says, you are mine. And the remnant sleeps in peace only when night is dawn in order to strengthen their journey and mission. And what you got to understand is I move into this word, and we're not going to do the video, Scott. We're just going to go right into the word because I feel this so strongly because I want to get to the altar experience. I believe with all my heart as God began to speak this to me and God began to tell me, get ready because I'm going to do something big. And you have to understand, church, there is a moment where, number one, darkness gets interrupted. For me, I write about an unqualified laying in a field at 16 years old running from God. I'd been with all my friends who were all drinking, and I'm kind of out of it. I'm laying in the field and suddenly saw heavens open, and I saw God begin to weep over me. And he said to me, if you don't change, you're running out of time. You know, the worst thing that could ever happen to you is for God to turn you over to yourself. But the end of yourself is the beginning of God. The Bible says in Revelation, the third chapter, and we all think this is a salvation verse. It's kind of taught. This is a salvation verse. It's a Roman road to salvation verse. And it's, you know, he's standing at the door and knocking. No, he's talking to the church. And Revelation 3, verse 2 says, wake up, strengthen the remnant. It's about to die, for I have found your deeds unfinished in the sight of my God. I'm out worshiping, and all of a sudden, I'm getting ready to speak at a conference. I'm at a lake. I'm down in Florida. I'm jogging around it. I've got to go leave the hotel and get to service. And all of a sudden, the Lord hit me, and he said, Pat, I'm going to awaken the Samuels in America. So I began to study Samuel. Samuel was a judge. He was also the first who stepped into the office of the prophet, who was Samuel. God raised him up at a time when the heavens were quiet. Who was Samuel? He would go into places and rebuild the altar of the Lord where it had been torn down. Who was Samuel? Began to study him. Who was Samuel? He was a kid who heard the voice of God. Who was Samuel? He was forgotten in the house of the Lord. You're never going to get anointed till you get forgotten. And I'm telling you the truth. The greater the anointing, the greater the isolation. And what you call quiet season, God calls preparation. When you've been put into a back somewhere and you're sitting there saying, God, when is my turn? When is my turn? See, I have learned the calling of God without the timing of God could result in the absence of God. And there is a moment, just because people have prophesied over you're going to do amazing things, you're going to do this or that, you have to go through the refining process. You have to go to the place where he crushes like an olive to get the anointing oil. You're not ready for that yet. We'd love to hand you the microphone, but you'll just embarrass the cross if we give it to you right now. Instead, we've got to take you through some things. You've got to walk through the process, and nobody likes the process to the promise. Everybody likes to jump from point A to point Z, but you got to go through BC. You got to go through the process. It's the refining process. It's the old 35 millimeter cameras. Remember those? You take a picture and there's a negative on it. Then it has to go through the dark room, and then it's got to get exposed. It's got to get stretched, and it's got to put through the process. And before you ever get to hold the picture, just because you've had a vision doesn't mean it's time for you to hold the picture. I remember at 16 years old having a dream of preaching in front of tens of thousands, and I didn't see that dream fulfilled till 36 years old, standing in Australia, and I walked out on stage and I went, dear God, this is the dream I had at 16. I wasn't ready. But see, you have to understand who was Samuel. Can I tell you some more about Samuel? Because I love him. We all know his story. We all know that, and I'm just going to be honest with you. I'll never forget growing up. My parents were very prophetic. They pastored these little churches in East LA, East Lower Alabama. Sounds cool. And my dad would bring in these prophets, and man, he'd line everybody up, and they'd start prophesying, and they'd walk right past me. One day I was thinking about that recently. I was praying about it. I said, Lord, how come I never got really prophesied over till I was about 16 years old? He said, Pat, I gave all those people their commercials. I'm going to give you a movie. And see, what you got to understand, here's Samuel. And the Bible says that his mother was married to a man by the name of Elkanah. I believe I'm saying that right. I never look at Pastor Mark when I say that. Who was also married to a woman by the name of Peninnah. Am I saying it correctly? Yeah. Okay, good enough. And the Bible says, I believe Elkanah was of the priestly order. And what you got to understand is the Bible says that he's married to two women, but he loved one more than the other. That's a messed up house. Very Mississippi-ish. I live in Alabama. I can say it. And so, the Bible says that Peninnah could have children. And, you know, birthing a child is proof of relationship. And so, in the public realm. And so, the Bible says that Hannah was so discouraged, so defeated over it because her womb was closed, that she would continually cry out to the Lord. And the Bible says that Elkanah even loved her more. He would give her double blessings. But church, there's a moment where you get tired of the blessings and you want to give birth to a prophetic movement. And finally, the Bible says they go to the house of Eli, and they're sitting there, and she cannot eat. She has no appetite because she's so provoked by Peninnah and all of her children, Pinocchio, Penelope, all the kids. Then finally, she gets up, walks into the temple of the Lord, and she begins to walk around. And she's making noises, but her lips aren't really moving. And all of a sudden, the high priest walks in and says, "Woman, are you drunk?" Isn't it amazing how the religious always misdiagnose the gifts of the Spirit? And she said, "No, sir, I'm not drunk." She was in intercession. She said, "I want a child, and if God will give me a child, I will give him back." And all of a sudden, the Bible says that he goes home. He says to her, "Go home. God's going to bless your womb." And we know from 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 21, that she had more children. But it says that she basically takes this small child and gives him to the house of the Lord, where he would grow up in a temple. Now, this bothered me. He grew up in the house of the Lord. And this bothered me because I could not figure this out. Why would God take him and put him in the house of Eli? Because Eli's house was messed up. Are you still with me? You know what I've learned? It's usually the ones that come out of the worst places that God uses the greatest. Because somewhere along the line, you begin to realize that what should have destroyed you becomes your testimony. And you begin to realize that God trusts you with the pain. And what you got to know is, he's living in the house of Eli. And he's living in a house where Eli and Hophni and Phinehas are living. And the Bible says, you have to understand, these are two corrupt boys. The Bible says basically that they are having sex with the women in the church. They're stealing the money. And here's Eli who's sleeping. He represents religion. So suddenly this boy is living in a house of perversion and a house of greed and a house of religion. And God puts him in there, and it really bothered me. And I said, "Lord, I don't understand. Why would you deliver this boy to this house? Why would he grow up in a house of perversion?" And the Lord said, "Because I never left him. I stood there with him the whole time." And the Bible says in 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 22, it says this in the Message Bible: "By this time, Eli was very old. He kept getting reports on how his sons and daughters were ripping off the people and sleeping with the women who helped out at the sanctuary. Eli took them to task and he said, 'What's going on here? Why are you doing these things? I hear story after story. These are terrible reports I'm getting. Stories spreading right and left among God's people. If you sin against another person, there's help, God's help. But if you sin against God, who is around to help you?'" You know what I've learned? The remnant will consist of the failures, the fatherless, the forgotten, and the freedom fighters whose pedigree is that of a scarred Savior. See, listen to me. Can you see him? He's living in the house of God. And outside of his bedroom is perversion and greed. God always raises people up from the darkest places. And finally, a prophet comes up to him, and this is no way to get invited back to a church. Look what it says in 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 31. A prophet walks up, and I promise you, there wasn't a praise offering at the end of this, and I bet this prophet did not get a love offering, because watch, all of a sudden he walks up to Eli, and he says, "Be well warned, it's over. It won't be long before I wipe out both your family and your future family. No one in your family will make it to an old age. You'll see good things that I'm doing in Israel, but you're going to see it and weep, for no one in your family will live to enjoy it." You need to stop right there and listen to me. There are spiritual lineages being cut off because those that God has entrusted with the anointing have not been true to it. And there are people that God is about to raise up to take up mantles that have been lying in the dust for too long. people that somewhere along the line stopped preaching truth. Now watch, because I'm going somewhere, because this really bothered me. Why in the world would God have Samuel live in this darkness? And it's Numbers chapter 16. Stand between the living and the dead and break the curses. Sometimes God takes those that he has anointed for such a time as this and puts them in the worst places because he knows their day is coming, and he'll raise them up to be a voice. Wherever you're working right now, you may not know why you're in that place. You may not know why you're in your neighborhood, but God said, I put you there, and there's going to come a moment. And what you got to realize is darkness has all across America tried to invade God's light. Are you still with me? And we are living in a very dark time in America. And when everything is measured by your happiness rather than by God's holiness, the very sense of our being sinners becomes secondary, if not offensive. We're living in a time where the celebrity culture of Christianity, where they preach, they say, look at me, because if they ever say, look at Jesus, they'll realize they don't look anything like him. So now we are living in the day of know not him, but give us Barabbas. Barabbas makes us feel a lot better about ourselves. And by the way, Barabbas, his very name means to lead an unholy revolution. And what you got to realize, it's Revelation chapter 3, verse 3. It says, remember therefore what you've received and heard, hold it fast and repent. But if you do not wake up, you know we are living at a time, and I wrote about this in Unqualified, on the rehiring of the Holy Spirit, because churches are now watering down the blood and giving the Holy Spirit a pink slip. And you, when you remove one-third of the Trinity, when you take one-third away from 100, it leaves the number 666. And we are now operating in the number of man. That's why 1 John says the Antichrist spirit came from within us. It came from out of the church. But God says, I'm going to raise up those that are desperate, because he is coming back with a feather, or not with a feather, but with a sword. Are you with me? He is separating the sheep and the goat. Just as he'll separate the sheep and the goat nations, he's separating the sheep and the goat. You know what a goat does? A goat will eat anything. And don't turn your back on a goat. They'll hurt you. And I am learning, trust me, the more you tell the truth, the smaller your crowd gets. And we are living in a time where truth is the new hate speech. And the enemy of truth is silence. And God says, I'm looking for those that will step up, because darkness has invaded his light. And he is looking for those that will stand up and begin to declare truth and authority across this nation. And it doesn't matter. Let the chips fall. Let them attack you. I always love it when I tweet something that makes everybody mad. I lose all these followers. Jesus felt that way one night. Listen. But the spirit of this age is to make sin seem normal and righteousness strange. And Jesus said it in Matthew 22, verse 14, many are going to get invited, but only a few are going to make it. But the remnant will not bow to culture, but rather culture is recreated by their passion for Jesus. And we are living in America in a compassion crisis. We literally, it is all about social justice. And I get it. I know we're supposed to have pure religion. James, take care of the poor. I understand that. But the compassion crisis is this. We love people's flesh more than we love their spirit, so we will not speak the truth so as not to lose their flesh. But that's why, literally, Jesus said in Matthew 22, verse 19, when speaking to the Pharisees, Jesus replied, you are in error because you do not know the scripture or the power of God. And Charles Spurgeon said it best. He said, discernment is not knowing the difference between right and wrong. It is knowing the difference between right and almost right. And we are living in a very intense time. And I don't know if you have that back there, Scott, but there's a bumper sticker. It's the Coexist bumper sticker. And it's the number one bumper sticker in the world. And when I was doing an apologetic series for universities, there it is right there. I was getting angrier and angrier at this because it's that Oprah doctrine. Basically, all religions are the same. We're all on the same path. That is a lie. There is only one way to heaven is Jesus. Are you with me? But I'll never forget, because I started getting madder and madder at it, and I'm doing this whole apologetic series, and this bumper sticker, I keep tripping over it because I see it everywhere. I even saw it on a church van. Basically, we're all in this together. We're all serving the same God. By the way, that's Hinduism. And so what you have to realize, and so all of a sudden the Lord began to speak to me, and he said, son, don't get mad. They're preaching my gospel. He said, look, they started with Ishmael, but they ended with Isaac. He said, look, son. He said this to me. Don't get upset. He said, because if you really study this bumper sticker, you can try Islam, Buddhism, science, Judaism, paganism, and Wiccan. But sooner or later, everything's going to stop at the cross, because every knee shall bow. Every tongue confess that Jesus. Come on and praise him. And we're living in a time where politicians are even running from the abortion issue. I'll never forget when I was on a plane a while back. It was the night before the last presidential election. I'm flying back home into Birmingham. I'm tired. I'd been in Ohio, and I'm flying home, and all of a sudden I sit down by this elderly lady, and the word fetus means little one or offspring. Yeah, and so you got to understand, we're living in a time where the very cries of a generation that has been martyred, 25% of a generation that has been murdered, the playgrounds of heaven are packed out because no one will stand up. And everybody goes, well, the Supreme Court always gets it right. Really? I've heard people say this to me. Yeah, Roe v. Wade, 1972. They got it right. I said, well, why don't you drop back 98 years before that in the same vote as 7-2 when they decided that a black man wasn't really a human being? Do they always get it right? And there's a vote coming up in America this week or next week that's going to come out deciding on marriage. I'm not talking about Matthew chapter 19 marriage. I'm not talking about Genesis 2 marriage. We better go to war and start praying. Are you with me so far? And if you find that offensive, there's a whole line you got to get behind those people. So watch. But darkness has invaded God's light. Nobody talks about this stuff anymore. And it is time. Because I was driving down through Houston. Karen was going to speak at a conference. And I began to hear the cries of children screaming. And I thought it was, we had just got off a plane. I thought it was, Abby was in the back seat asleep. I thought it was one of her dolls. And I looked back. There was nothing there. And suddenly, I'm driving past the largest Planned Parenthood building in America. And I could hear the cries of the babies. And I'm reminded, sitting on a flight the night before the election, and all of a sudden, as I'm sitting there, God just does stuff to me to mess with me. And I sit down on the flight, and I look over this little old lady. She's in her 70s, and I said, hi, I'm Pat. I'm tired. I didn't really want to talk to anybody, but she said, so what do you do? I said, well, I'm a minister and an author. And she goes, oh, really? She said, well, I've worked for Planned Parenthood for 40 years, and I just want to look up and go, really? And so I'm sitting there, and all of a sudden I looked at her. I said, hey, can I, we talked for a moment, and I said, can I tell you my opinion of abortion? She goes, well, here we go. And I said, yeah. I said, it's kind, and the Lord gave me this on the flight. I said, it's kind of like this. When I get home tonight, I can go burn down my house. I own my house. Now, I got to pay the bank too, but I own it. I said, I have the right to burn down my house. She said, you're right. I said, unless someone's in it. I said, then I lose all my rights. We didn't talk anymore. It got weird anyway. But what you got to understand is the reason why I'm sharing this with you is, church, you got to get a hold of this. Because some of you have been through some of the darkest times, and scars on earth are testimonies in heaven. And it's what Karen always says, it's impossible to have compassion without first having pain. And this really bothered me. I was praying through this whole story, and I'm going, God, why did you abandon him? And the Lord said to me as I was praying, he said, I never abandoned him. Now watch. And God told me to come and declare some over your lives tonight. I've come to speak hope to you. The nightmare is almost over. God told me to tell you that darkness is about to end. There is a moment when he begins to interrupt your life. And you need to understand, while the party was going on, while the porn was on the computers outside his room, while the greed was going on outside, while Eli was down the hall snoring in the religion, Samuel was laying there in the presence of the Lord. And what I love about Samuel is, no matter the atmosphere he lived in, no matter the environment, he still laid in the presence of God. Am I talking to anybody in here? Am I talking to somebody that's been through some things? And the Bible says in 1 Samuel chapter 3, watch this. And the boy Samuel was serving God under Eli's direction. And this was at a time when the revelation of God was rarely heard or seen. Hello, America! And one night Eli was sound asleep. His eyesight was very bad. He could hardly see. How many of you understand religion takes vision? Right from you. It was well before dawn. The sanctuary lamp was still burning, and Samuel was still in bed in the temple of God where the chest of God rested. Then God called out, Samuel! Samuel! You know what I've learned, church? God can in one moment take your depression. In one moment, he can break things off of you. Have you ever screamed, I wish this nightmare was over? I love Isaiah 50, verse 10. It says, who among you fears the Lord? Let him who walks in the dark and obeys the word of a servant. Let him who walks in the dark, who has no light, trust the name of the Lord and rely on his God. That's one of my favorite verses. I'll never forget. 7 years ago, I flew from Monterey, California. Had just saw 30,000 touched at a thing called Spirit West Coast. And they had raced to the altars. I flew home, got home, went to bed. Next morning, 5 a.m., my phone rings. And it rang a couple times. And all of a sudden, it was my dad. And he said, your sister died. Wake up, your sister died. And I'll never forget racing an hour away to the hospital, early hours of the morning. My sister had been struggled with drugs. She got radically saved 4 weeks before she died, but her body was done. Her heart, she had congestive heart failure. And so I get to the hospital. I'm sitting there looking at her dead body, and I was so angry. I was so angry at hell. And she was 2 years older than me. She was 39 years old. It was 7 years ago. And all of a sudden, I'll never forget driving home down the freeway, and I rolled down the window, and I screamed, "Wake me up from this nightmare, God." It took 6 months to get that off me. One day Karen came home, and I'm sitting at the top of the stairs right in front of my prayer room, and I'm just sitting there like this. And Karen said to me, "He's right behind you." She walked in the door. She said, "He's right behind you. Go up. He wants to talk to you. Go wrestle." And I got free. But have you ever been through something where you said, "God, wake me up"? It's Ephesians 5, verse 14. It says, this is why it said, "Wake up, sleeper, rise from dead, and Christ will shine on you." And God told me to come and tell you tonight, simple word that I must share, because get ready, you're going to have an encounter in just a moment. He told me to come and tell you, He's nocturnal. God can see you in the dark. It reminds me of years ago, I had been traveling too much, and Nate was a little boy, he's about 6 years old, and all of a sudden, about 3 o'clock in the morning, I hear, "Daddy!" Jumped out of bed, and I run into his room, and I said, what? He goes, "I just need to hear your voice. You've been gone a lot." I said, "It's 3 a.m. He said, "I know." And I laid down beside him, and I began to sing worship to him, and I fell asleep, and I woke up very sore because kids will hurt you. They'll beat you to death. God told me to come and tell some of you to wake up. He hasn't gone anywhere. And Samuel lived in a place where the heavens were quiet and deception was in the very next room. You know who the remnants are? And I just, one of the things the Lord just gave me in Unqualified, I wrote a whole manifesto for it, but the unqualified are always the ones that would rather be in a small crowd of the hungry than a large congregation of the lethargic. Put me around people that can walk up to me in this room and say, "Can I tell you what God did to me this morning?" When's the last time you walked out of your prayer closet limping? When's the last time you wrestled with Him and He changed your name? When's the last time you walked up Moriah and said, "I go worship"? Would you call sacrifice God calls worship? When's the last time you walked up there and wrestled yourself back to the rock and said, "God, do the work inside of me. Tie me tight, Father, for I don't want to move"? When's the last time you began to get to that place where you said, "God, I am tired of being the filter of this world. I am ready to be the one that stands up and puts the shield of faith up and says, enemy, you cannot have my mind. You cannot have my spirit. You're not stepping over me. I don't have to be a part of this world. I don't have to have cognitive dissonance. I don't have cognitive dissonance. Where I hear so many lies so often I begin to believe it's truth. God says, I'm looking for those that can pick up this word and begin to chew on it. Are you with me? Give Him a praise. I want to live somewhere between amen and there it is. What I love about Samuel is even living in the darkest place, he stayed pure. And the Bible says in 1 Samuel chapter 3, verse 4, then God called out, "Samuel, Samuel." Samuel answered, "Yes, I'm here." Can you see him? He wakes up. He's so excited. Somebody remembered him. He runs into Eli's room. "Did you call me stepdad?" "I didn't call you. Go back and lie down." See, a lot of people don't understand. When you hear the voice of the Lord, most of the time it sounds like your pastor or your spiritual father. Can you see him walking back to bed? "Oh, somebody's playing a trick on me." So he did again. And God called again, "Samuel, Samuel." He gets out of bed. He runs back into Eli's room. Hey, did you call me stepdad? You called me, right? "Here I am." "Son, I did not call you. Go back to bed." Now, this is my favorite part of this verse. This is so powerful. This all happened before he had a revelation of God. Oh, you're not getting it yet. long before you had a revelation of God, he was speaking to you. He was saying, go to sleep, ignore the arguing in the other room. He was saying, don't get in the car with those people. He was talking what you might have thought was kind of some kind of intuition, what you kind of thought was just something you thought up. God was saying, no, I'm talking to you. He hasn't gone anywhere. He knit you together in a secret place. He's the author and the finisher. He wrote the book and shows up for the book signing. He says, I've been talking to you. I'm the one that's been there. I'm the one that's been whispering to you. You thought it was something else. You thought it was your mind. I'm the one that's saying, don't go to that party. I'm the one that's saying, don't get in that car. But you just hadn't had a revelation of him yet. It's going to be amazing when you hear his voice and suddenly realize you've been hearing it for a long time. Somebody give my God a praise. Oh, I hear this sound of awakening coming. Get ready. We're almost there. It's Psalms 18:28. You, O Lord, keep my lamp burning. See, God knows just the right moment to interrupt your darkness. It's the family. When I was in Virginia last year, and I was ministering in Virginia, and all of a sudden, last year, year before last, I'm not sure, all of a sudden, this family comes up to me after I had preached my "Why is God so mad at me?" message, and they just got wrecked on the love of God. Just the agape was all over them, and they're just sitting there, and all of a sudden, I'm signing books. The church asked me to sign books after service. It is in Virginia, and independent, charismatic, Pentecostal, everything church, and all of a sudden, as I'm signing books, this pastor's wife walks up and whispers to me and says, "Hey, this family wants to meet you." I said, "Oh, okay. Husband, wife, teenage daughter, okay." And she whispers, she says, "Their son was just killed in a car accident. And because the enemy used to torture me with fear, I immediately dropped the book." And she says, "He got saved last Easter. He's 19 years old." She's whispering in my ear, but he got killed at Myrtle Beach in an accident. And so immediately I dropped the book. Now, this is a true story. All of a sudden I turned to the woman and I grabbed her by the hands. And all I said to her was, ignoring all the others around me, I can't imagine your pain. It was deep compassion. You know, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. We kind of get that wrong. We think about, if I didn't watch this on TV. No, when your motives are pure, you're going to see God. It's about when you get everything else in order. My motives were so pure. All I said was, "I can't imagine your pain." And instantly I was standing in heaven. And I saw the throne of the Lord. And all I could see was the glory and the light. And I could see the feet of God. But all of a sudden I see this tall, lanky, redheaded kid dancing before the Lord. I know it's crazy. And he's worshiping like this. And he has a red plaid shirt on in heaven. And immediately, red hair. I turned back to the woman. Now, I didn't know. She didn't have red hair. Her husband was bald. Who knows what he had? And so immediately I'm like, I'm right back in front of her. And she's talking. And I said, ma'am, I need to ask you something. I said, was your son tall? She said, oh, tall and lanky. I said, he had red hair. She goes, yeah. I said, did he worship like this? And the pastor's wife said, like a spread eagle. See, they didn't know if he made it to heaven because they didn't know how he died, what he was doing the night he got killed. They were very worried. They had no peace. And I said, okay, I'm going to ask you something else kind of silly. I said, I've never asked anybody anything like this. I said, but did your son have a red plaid shirt that he loved? And the teenage daughter looks at me, standing behind mom. And she goes, I go in his room and smell it every day. I said, ma'am, I just saw your baby dancing in heaven. Holy Ghost hits the foyer of the church. A wave of God. People start falling out all around me. The father, who is bitter and angry at God, hits his knees. The mother goes backwards about 15 feet. Nobody could catch her. She just can't stop until she's out. See, there comes a moment when God interrupts your pain. There comes a moment when God interrupts your darkness. There comes a moment. Oh, I wish you'd get a hold of this. There comes a moment when God walks in and says, watch me be God. At that moment, you didn't see it coming, and I got a little bit out of it. I saw heaven. It's the story of Abby coming up to Karen one day and saying, mommy, I had a dream last night. And Karen goes, really? And I was on the road. And all of a sudden, she says, yeah, I had a dream and Jesus came and saw me. And he reminded me that when I was in the orphanage in China, he used to come and whisper, Abby, hold on, your mommy's coming. And then all of a sudden she said, and mommy, he came and saw me in my sleep last night and said, see, Abby, I told you she was coming for you. And we laughed. And then Abby ran off. Karen calls me on the phone to tell me this story. She says, you're not going to believe what our little girl just told us. She starts telling me the story. I get so wrecked. I'm in a hotel room. I'm weeping. I think I took an offering from myself. Amen. You ain't giving to your... You ain't got messed up to you like I got to give. Listen. Oh, listen, church. You got to get a hold of this. You can't avoid my God in the dark. He's nocturnal. It's Psalms 139. He says, I see you in the worst places. I see you in the dark places. Is there any place I can go to avoid your spirit, to be out of your sight? If I climb to the sky, you're there. If I go underground, you're there. If I flew on the morning wings to the far western horizon, you'd find me in a minute. You're already there. You're already there waiting. Then I said to myself, oh, he even sees me in the dark. At night, I'm immersed in the light. It's a fact. Darkness isn't dark to you. Night and day, darkness and light, they're all the same to you. Give my God a praise. I've come to tell somebody in this room. You've been walking through some things. My God told me to come and tell you the enemy's a liar. God had plans for you from the foundation of the earth. You were birthed in the loins of God. Jesus gave a promise in John chapter 14. I don't leave you like some orphan Barefoot. I don't leave you, abandon you. I gave you my spirit. I don't walk out on nobody. I am a father that completes what I start. Somebody give him a praise. You were a part of God's plan. Running around like you just kind of got picked up in this thing. I'm telling you, I just wrote a new message called The Unqualified Entrepreneur. If you begin to realize how God wants to bless you, I am so tired of telling people they should be blessed. If you begin to realize that he takes joy in your prosperity, that he gives you the ability to create wealth, if you begin to realize what he's already done to you, he's already put inside of you, what gets boring to you and real easy to you is what you're going to make money off of, or you ain't getting that. See, you got to understand, God says, I've already put things inside of you. I've already promised things about you. I've already declared things. I'm writing the book about you, Malachi. He said, I've already made the promises to you. He said, he's already been put this thing together. There's a novel in heaven that says Schatzline, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, Spitzbergen. Oh, there's a bunch of them. And so you got to understand, God says, I've been waiting on you. And you got to ignore the lies and distractions of the enemy, because God is about to burst something in your life. He's about to bring forth a fire. He's about, oh, you got to get this. I'm so excited. And Samuel is laying in bed in a demonic place. The temple of the Lord has been overtaken by perversion. Where more humanistic messages are preached from pulpits in America than any college classroom. Welcome to America. Where pastors are refusing to stand up and speak truth for fear of losing coffers and pews. But God, he's whistling and calling people out of the cave that suddenly come out. Yes, Lord. Did you need me? Oh, Obadiah, I need you to feed the prophets. See, there's a moment. I got to get done. I got to get done. I got to get done. I'm going long-winded here. It's y'all's fault. Now watch. The first two times he goes into Eli's room, Eli says what the devil always says to you. When you start to get used by God, the devil always tell you these three things. God didn't call you. Go on back. Lie down. But the very ministry and work of Jesus Christ is so different. He always said, get up, come forth. I've anointed you. Hey! God didn't ever call you to lie down. He called you to take a stand. See, when you lose your purpose, you embrace passivity. And what you got to understand is Romans 13. It says, wake up. You can't afford. We can't afford to waste a minute of time. must not squander these precious daylight hours in frivolity and indulgence and sleeping around in dissipation and bickering and grabbing everything in sight. Get out of bed. Get dressed. Don't loiter. Waiting until the very last minute. Dress yourselves in Christ and be up and about. Oh, listen. And this is it. Don't you dare. And you've probably heard me use this verse. I love this verse. Don't you dare stop at your moment of breakthrough. See, something happened in our ministry this morning. A financial need hit this morning. You know what I did? Because I can remember a time as a head of this ministry where it would just wallop me. I'd try to figure out every way to get man to respond to it. You know what I did? I went and got in the shower and got clean off that lie. And all of a sudden, I began to praise God. And the Lord said, I'm right here beside you. And he says, the Lord is attentive to the prayers of the righteous. And he turns his face to the evildoers. And what you got to understand is, oh, you got to watch this, because some of you are at your moment of breakthrough. I feel it so strongly. It makes me want to drink some communion juice. And so there's a moment. Y'all got that unleavened over there. There's a moment when all of a sudden you go, wait a minute, I always stop right here. Remember years ago, Karen was wrong about something, and we were fussing, and she said, you know what? We always get off on this exit. Let's not get off on this exit. And it broke a arguing spirit off our house, and then it brought forth a love spirit. What? And so what you got to understand is, y'all just got married. Y'all can hear that. And some of you are at the corner of destiny and circumstances, and your circumstances are screaming at you. But God says, walk away. Pull over here with me. Come away with me. And you're just about ready to quit. But I love what it says in 1 Peter. It says, friends, when life gets really difficult, don't think that God isn't on the job. Quite the contrary. Don't jump to the conclusion he's not there. Instead, be glad that you're in the very thick of what Christ experienced. This is your spiritual refining process. Now, look what it goes on to say. Somebody help me with it. Because all of a sudden, you're going and you're pushing against the enemy. You're pushing against the lies of hell. You're pushing, and you're like, I feel like quitting. I'm getting tired. I feel like Gideon's army. We're fainting, yet we're pursuing. Daniel says he'll wear us out in the last days. That's why you're so tired on Sunday and not Saturday. And so you're pushing, and 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 you're pushing. And all of a sudden, it says you're going to turn the corner. And about the time you turn the corner, the glory of God is going to hit you with glory just around the corner. Hey! That's it. Here comes his glory. Here comes a wave of his glory now. Holy Spirit hit. Here comes a wave of his glory. I just felt him say that to me. He's going to hit. He's going to start hitting. God's restoring. God is sweeping ashes off of lives right now. He just told me that. I'm restoring beauty to where ashes are. The presence of God is all over this room. The remnant generation is rising up because we have decided at all costs we not allow the next generation to speak of the last generation does not want to see God's glory. And what you got to understand is his presence is sweeping now. There are people that you had lost hope. Hope deferred makes the heart sick, but a longing fulfilled is a tree of life. You're going to plant trees tonight. Oh, you're not getting this yet. God told me to come and tell you. Depression is falling off some of you. You've been secretly depressed. I felt that three times. There are people that are battling secret depression. You can't tell anybody because the people you're closest to, you're afraid. You're afraid they won't understand it. But God says, I'm about to restore balance to your brain. I'm about to put joy in your spirit. You're going to wake up at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 in the morning. Should we be out of church at that time? You're going to wake up and you're going to be laughing and not understand it. Somebody shout. Samuel could have quit. I must be losing my mind. I keep hearing somebody call my name. About 3 weeks, 4 weeks ago, we're doing I Am Remnant in Oklahoma City. And God was moving, and I brought my son. Karen couldn't go, so I brought my son in. Nate flew in and preached one of the most powerful messages I had ever heard in my life. Not just because he was my son, it just messed me up. On the love of God, I'm just messed up in the service. So I walk up on stage because we like to flow together in the altar, my son and I. And the minute I put my foot on the stage, I started laughing. I couldn't stop laughing. And I said, Lord, why am I laughing? He's in a serious moment. I'm laughing. It's awkward. I'm that guy. And all of a sudden, the Lord said, 7 years ago when your sister died, you lost your joy in me. I'm restoring it through your son right now. And boom, Holy Ghost hits me. I start laughing. I'm a new man. Am I a new man, Karen? For 4 weeks, I've been a new man. Something changed. Something shifted. Something died. Oh, there ain't nothing like laughing when you ought to be crying. There ain't nothing like laughing when you ought to be worried about stuff. There ain't nothing like laughing when fear ought to be overwhelming you. But when you're just sitting there laughing, my God is sovereign. It's hitting, isn't it? I feel it. Joy's hitting the room. I feel joy hitting this room. Hey, bitch. Hey, hala, bakote. I feel joy. I feel joy overwhelmed. I don't know what's going on. Oh. Makes me want to sing. Like a bridge over troubled water. You know what I mean? That's what I feel. That was stupid. Now watch. You go ahead and be bored as a Christian. You go ahead and whirl around. Jesus is going to put you out of the house, you professional mourner. There's a moment where you got to walk in and say, he's here, he's here, he's here, he's sovereign, he's God, he's powerful, he's almighty. Is it? Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. See, you have sat back and said, but Lord, look at my past, look at my mistakes, look at all those things, Lord. And then the Lord keeps saying, I'm going to use you. Yeah, yeah. But I don't come from some spiritual heritage. Oh, that makes it better. Because then you ain't got crutches, you got wings. And the Bible says in verse 9 and 10, third time he runs into the room. He hears Samuel. Samuel, he runs in. And all of a sudden, Eli says to him, go on back and lie down. But as he's walking out the door, the Holy Ghost hits Eli. He says, hey, I remember what it was like to hear his voice before I got so fat and lusty in the anointing. Before I sat leaned up against the wall snoring as sin went through the house of God. And this time, son, if you hear it again, simply say, speak, for your servant is listening. Then you see Samuel. I think he was probably about 15 years old. I don't know. He goes and he lays down. And the voice of the Lord says to him, Samuel. It happened to Karen last year, middle of the night, 2 o'clock in the morning. Karen, she woke me up. What? I'm like, I didn't say anything. And it was God getting ready to write Dehydrated, the book. It used to happen to our son all the time. He'd be upstairs. Did you call me, Mom? And then Karen just started going, you need to just say speak, for the servant is listening. The Bible says he goes and lays down. And God came to him as he did other times. Somebody say other times. Exactly as before. And he said, Samuel, Samuel. And Samuel raises up and says, your servant's listening. I wonder if God smiled. I got your attention. In the very next verse, he says, oh, Samuel. I'm about to do something in Israel. I'm about to do something in San Diego. It's going to shake everybody up. I'm about to do something in America. I'm about to do something in Birmingham. I'm about to do something. I'm about to do something in Beirut. I'm about to do something in Saudi Arabia. I'm about to do something in Stockholm. I'm about to do something in South Africa. I'm about to do something in San Salvador. That if I would have told you. But it's going to get their attention. ones abandoned, the ones put off to the side. I can remember as a boy when my mom tried to commit suicide and they put her in a mental hospital. Pastor's kid. And I would read Psalms 91 every night. And then I begin to see 9/11 on everything. And I still see it two or three times a day, don't I? I'll go, look, 9/11. We pray as a family every time I see it. I didn't know why I was seeing it. And then he showed me Amos 9/11. The restoration of the tabernacle of David when the remnant shall come forth. There's a lot more verses. If you'd have told me then that it would use me now, I would say no way. But when we say no way, God says Yahweh. Because he's raising up the ones that have been through a whole lot of hell, that come out shining as gold. Would you do something for me? It may be a little awkward for you, but I feel like I'm supposed to do this. Because just like the Lord showed my little Abby, my princess, that he was there. He wants to show you he was there. Before you ever knew him, he was there. He says, I'll never leave you, forsake you. See, God loves you so much that it won't be till after you're gone that he has to forget you if you don't choose him. He has to say, I never knew you. But right now he's calling. He's calling. He's written your name on his hand. He's been declaring things over you in the middle of the night. I feel the presence of God. He's been speaking things over you. Oh, there's an anointing. Can you do something for me? Would you shut your eyes? Say this. No, open your eyes. Look at me. Say this. Say, Lord, take me back to my darkest moment. Even before I knew you and truly understood your love. Take me back to my worst moment. Now listen, I don't know what your worst moment is. For me, it was my sister. It's worst. That one still stabs periodically. I don't know your worst moment. Maybe it was when somebody said you're worthless. Maybe when somebody walked out on you. Maybe when somebody said they want a divorce. Maybe it was a phone call, a test result. Maybe it was an accident. I don't know. Maybe it was standing by a casket. I don't know where your worst moment. But if he truly would never leave you nor forsake you, if he's a good father, which he is, if he can visit my baby, he visited you. You're not an oops or an accident. You're not here by chance. So say this, Lord. Say it louder. Lord, come on with boldness. When you call on his name, you say the name of the Lord with power and authority. Lord, when I shut my eyes, take me back to my worst moment. Show me that you were in the room. I believe that he gives visions and dreams in the last days. I really do. You need to understand. Say, Lord, when I shut my eyes, take me to my worst moment. I want to see you in the room. You ready? Shut your eyes now. Do you see him? He's there. He's on the side of the bed. He never left you. He never walked. He was there in the hospital, wiping your brow as your little sweetheart was gasping for breath. He was right there. Just show me that. He was there when your parents walked out on each other. He was there when someone came into your room inappropriately. He was there weeping over you. Now what's going to happen is the Spirit of the Lord is going to hit you. And I'm warning you about this next part. It's going to get intense because this is what happens in our services when religion isn't present. So you need to understand, and it's not present tonight. There's a freedom here because there comes a moment. I'm going to show you something. Summer, give me your hand. Give me your hand. I don't know why this may seem weird to you, but it's something the Lord does sometimes to me. Can I take, come here, come here, if you can stand. Okay, I'm going to want to warn you. Give me your hand. The Spirit of the Lord sometimes lets me see a certain spot where people are supposed to go, because he's designated that spot in the history of time, and he's there. And so I feel the Lord taking me to show you this, and I'm not being weird when I do this. Okay, hold on. You're not there yet. I'm warning you. It's going to get heavier. A little bit closer. No. A little bit. That. Just corner of a step. Corner of a step. A little bit back. There. He's been waiting. He's been waiting. You need to come help me. He's been waiting. I usually have people. See, what's going to happen is the Spirit of the Lord is going to sweep over this room now, because he wants you to know that he's been calling your name. So say this out loud. Say, Father, speak my name to me. Did he call you by your first name that nobody ever uses?
Yeah, he did, didn't he? There's about to be a cleansing stream through the house. Stand with me across the house if you physically can, but I need to warn you, it's going to get heavier and heavier. It's going to get heavier and heavier and heavier and heavier and heavier and heavier and heavier, heavier and heavier. People that God has been waiting to use.
Hit him, God, now. Hit him, Lord, now. Yep. He's coming on like a mantle. I don't even have touch. He's coming on like a mantle. There he is. Hey! That's the glory of the Lord. We're not giving an altar call because I think we've abused that word. But, yeah. The awakening is happening. Spirit of the Lord, overwhelm. I'm looking for somebody. I'm trying to figure out who he wants me to find. Somebody he's been waiting on for an encounter.
Come here. You just asking him. Let it be you. You just asking. Lord said you ask him. The Lord said you ask him. So now it's your fault. The Lord said you ask him. Hold on. We gotta wait. He'll show me. Ha ha. Okay. All right. I need to warn you. You're going to step into the presence of God in a new way. One more step. One more. Nah. A little bit. Move that foot up. Just a little bit right there. Weight of his glory. Dreams and visions are being released in this room tonight. Some of you need to go to bed with a pen and paper. If you're desperate for God, cry out to him. Cry out to him. Cry out to him. Cry out to him.
There's a remnant in this room. Just like this bottle of water, he said, I'll be with you. I'll be in you. And then he said, I'll even come upon you. And when he does, you got.
Ideas, the Lord says.
The Lord says you are an inventor. I even think you've been stolen from. But the Lord says, son, seke, deeper, now! Hello, called. Hello, called of God. Hey, you can't wait on man to say it. You can't wait on family to approve it. The weight of the nations all over this room. I must be very careful because it's going to get thicker and more thick and all that. Must be very careful. He's here. There are people in this room that have become comfortable with your sin. I'm asking the Lord, let you taste it now. If you can taste that he is good, then you can taste the depth of your sin. Your mouth is going to begin to taste like dirt. You're going to begin to taste like dirt, as Hosea mentioned, the grumbling of the rocks, the crumbling of the rocks in your mouth. And all over this room, if you have sin in your life, God says, I want to awaken you out of your darkness. If you have sin in your life, you've allowed perversion in, and you think you can be a bipolar Christian, and God says, stop it! You have become a worker of iniquity if you're not careful. And the Lord says, if you have sin in your life, you don't have any reason to be embarrassed. We were all there. And so was he. But if you have sin in your life and you said, I need a declaration of truth to take place in my life and I need freedom, I need God to break sin off my life. I have not, maybe you've never accepted him or you've walked away from him, you've invited sin in your life. I will not beg you. I will not barter with you. I do not believe in manipulating you. I'm too classy for that, and so are you. If you have sin in your life, it's going to be one call. And if you feel the taste of sin in your life, raise your hand as high as you can now. Raise it up high. Higher. If you just raise your hand as quickly as you possibly can, get to the front. But before you do that, there's going to be a Holy Spirit line that you're going to cross. And when you cross it, it's going to hit you right there. Come on. I'm not begging you. I'm not begging you. You got a minute to get down here because we got to get with the saints here in a moment. We got to get you free first. Come on. You got sin in your life. You're in the back. Come on. God loves you enough to absolutely drive you crazy. He will drive you crazy. He will drive. Hey! Clean the eyes. Clean the eyes. All over the house, raise one hand and say, I will. And raise the other hand and say, surrender. And say, Spirit of the Lord, invade me. Jesus, forgive me. Jesus, anoint me. Jesus, change me. Be Lord of my life. I confess with my mouth, Jesus Christ is Lord. Is Lord. He is Lord. Father, forgive me. This day, I offer my life to you. Now lift your hands. The Holy Ghost is going to hit you. You're going to speak in tongues all over the front. He's going to fill you with the Holy Ghost now. A language between you and God. It is a mystery. It's powerful. Are you ready? Say, Holy Spirit. And he's going to breathe on you like he did John 20, the disciples. First altar call after the cross. But now here comes the upper room experience. You ready? Breath of God hit them. So that now say, Holy Spirit, invade me. Fill me with the Holy Ghost. With my language. Between me and the Father. Jesus, baptize me in fire now. That's it. Pray in the spirit. Pray in the spirit. Can't mess it up. Can't mess it up. Can you go to heaven without it? Yes, but you need it for work. You need it for the grocery store. No more fear, God says. No more fear, God says. No more fear, God says. Death is not at your door. His glory is at your door. No fear. Okay, you ready? It's about to get really real. 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 Let the glory of the Lord rise above. Rise above. Now I'm going to invite the whole house to walk up, but some of you aren't going to make it. You're going to trip over his glory because there's a spiritual line that he has drawn. And if you're desperate for God, walk to the front now. Hello, remnant. Hello, little remnant. Second time's a charmer. Ah. Waking my soul to the fire of the Lord. Cry out to him, church. Somebody shout, wake me up. Here it comes. Here comes the wave. Stand there for a moment. Well, hello, India. Welcome to San Diego, dear. My daughter's back there. Here comes the wave. He told me to wait a minute. I got to wait on him. Yes, Father. See, two-thirds of God's name is go, so you need to learn how to wait on the green light. Okay. Holy Spirit, come like a flood in a wave now. Now, here it comes. Oh, now. Like a flood. Like a wave. I saw the wave in a dream. It's coming. Where's Josh? Joshy, come help me. Wake up, Samuel! Hello, REMNANT. Hello, REMNANT. I just saw the Lord sewing something on you, a patchwork. I just saw the needle. I just saw the patchwork, the patchwork, the patchwork. What is it, Lord? Tell me what it is, please. See the Lord sewing patchwork. Ha! God calls you the chief of the army. He's putting royal remnant upon you. Elizabeth, the Lord says, don't grow weary in well-doing in the proper time. Harvest. But the Lord says, harvest is now, Elizabeth. Now, Elizabeth. More. More. Saw a remnant. I saw a remnant hidden in the midst. Remnant, hey, Sebeke.
Like a flood pour out.
So,
coming like the rain.
The enemy cannot have your seed. God says, watch me work, daughter. Hello, remnant. Hello, remnant. Hello, remnant. Life is going to be inside your spirit. Hello, remnant.
Come like the rain.
The authority of the Lord is upon you. The authority of the Lord is upon you. He says, I've had you in the sifting place. You will rise up like Gideon. Hey, no more fear. I see the Lord plundering and restoring what was robbed from you. I don't know what it is, but I see a basket of joy. Spirit of the Lord is upon me. The Spirit of the Lord is upon you. Hey! Ha 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 ha.
Because he's anointed me.
Hello, Cade. The Lord says you're not in the family business. You're about his business. I see God breaking off pieces of country and handing them to you, Kate. Pieces of countries.
Thank you, Father.
Like bread on the plate. The Lord says, never again shut your eyes doubting whether or not he has anointed you. Never again doubting whether God can use you. You didn't trip into the anointing. You were born in the anointing. The anointing is upon you. The Lord says, you are not a failure. The Lord says, you're my voice. Oh, we're not done. We're not done.
The voice of the Lord is upon you.
Can I slide? In this hand I see a rope, and in this hand I see a winnowing rod. You will break down the harvest, and you will rescue the harvest. And this lip will burn with a holy fire. This tongue will burn with a holy fire. Visions and dreams now will break out when you sleep at night. Okay, you ready?
Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus.
Hey, baby, say, okay.
Come like the rain, oh God.
Let's worship. Let us worship. Shall we?
Oh, I feel your spirit now.
Oh, hold on. It never says Samuel was sick as a boy because he was in the presence of the Lord. Much to be learned from that. There are people God wants to heal right now.
Yes.
There are physical healings that are supposed to break out across this room right now. I'm telling you, I see a tear in the lower back. God wants to heal it now. Where are you at? Shake your hand at me. You say, I got back issues. Raise your hand. Where? Yeah. Yeah, stand up. Stand up. Stand up. I just saw a tear in the lower back. It's a muscle tear that doesn't want to heal. It's constant. It's crippling at times. You get frozen. It locks you up. Heal. Sick. Where's it at? What side of the back? Right there? It's right there. Yeah.
Hey, I speak to this body to come into divine alignment with the word of the Lord, and I rub my hands down the scars on the back for healing was already brought.
That's right.
You are one portion of the body operating separate from the rest of the body. So I say, align yourself with Jesus. Make the authority of life now.
Lift your hands and cry out to the Lord, would you, for just a second? Come on, I can't hear you. Can't hear you. Come on. Don't get weary. Don't get weary.
Holy Spirit.
Who's been battling depression? Raise your hand, shake it. Be honest, shake your hand. Raise both hands now. And reach up like this. Like this, like you're picking something up off a shelf in front of you. You're about to put on the crown of joy. Ready? So the Lord says, take the crown, hold it up. Say, in Jesus' name, joy, fall upon me now. No more depression. No more discouragement. Devil is a liar. Jesus is life. Put the crown on now. Whoa! You feel that? Yeah. There's a crown waiting on you. Somebody shout out, I am remnant. Shout out, I am remnant. Tell him, say, you're remnant, you're remnant, you're remnant. Now begin to thank him for being in the dark place. Begin to thank him for being where you didn't know he was at. He was in the hospital room. Thank him for where he was at. Thank him for where he's at. Your thankfulness brings forth miracles. Thankfulness opens the door to the next miracle. Wind of heaven, breathe fresh and anew upon your people, Lord. Hold on. He's walking. Hold on. No music. Hold on. Shut your eyes. He just told me he's walking through the crowd. You'll be able to tell by who he bumps into, where he's at. Is he bumping into you yet? I mean, I don't know that I've ever done this. He just said this to me. It's years ago he showed this to me, but he said, I'm walking. He's healing body parts right now. You're going to feel it. He's going to touch your body right now. He's going to touch your legs right now. You're going to feel it. He's going to just sweep over you. He's going to sweep over you. Oh, he's sweeping over you. I see it. Jesus. I have no idea, Ruth Anna, why he's touching your shoulders, but he is. Jesus. You prophet. So makatai. Oh, daughter. The Lord wants you to know he made your hands first.
Boronus.
Because there's healing in those hands. So lele bekese. Come on, praise him. Radical. Where the Spirit is, there's free. Who's got lost loved ones at home right now? Shake your hand at me. Okay, shake him. Say, God. Okay, get ready, because he's going to open a door. Get ready. Say, God. Invade my house now. You have liberty in my house. Wake him up.
Like the rain, like a flood upon us.
Wake up the lost!
Like a flood upon us.
Yes, Lord! Come like the rain, like a flood upon us.
see him walking through the door. I see him in your father's bedroom. I see him leaning over the chair. He fell asleep in front of the TV. But the Lord is
come like the rain,
massaging his spirit
like the blood upon us.
Wave of glory hit again. Wave of glory hit. Wave! The wave! Heavenly visions! Thy kingdom come!
Come like the rain, like a flood upon us. Come like the rain.
The Lord just said, if you have cares in your life that you're ready to be free of the cares, he said, cast them in the air now. So take your hands like a basket and say, Jesus, because he'll turn a care into a dove, I'm telling you. Just say, Jesus, here. Feel that lift?
Like a flood upon us. Come like the rain. Like a flood upon us. For our soul is thirsty. For our spirit cries. For it's you alone, O God, that we're looking for, thirsty for. Oh, come like the rain, like a flood upon us, for it's you, oh Lord, that we're thirsty for, that our heart cries out, come now.
No eye is seen, no ear is heard. No eye is seen, no ear is heard. What the Father has laid out for his children. How great is the love that he's lavished on me.
Oh, God.
That I am called his boy.
Oh, God. Come like the rain, like a flood upon us.
Come like the rain.
For it's you that we are thirsty for, and our heart desires so much more.
Sebekesete.
Come like the rain, like a flood upon us. For we're thirsty, Lord, for you. For we're hungry, Lord, for you. Oh, come like the rain.
If you have sickness in your home, and you want to see God heal it, your children have asthma, maybe something with your husband, your spouse, your wife, whatever. What if it's in your home and it's chronic? I don't know who you are. Raise both your hands now. If there's chronic sickness that keeps attacking your house, maybe it's allergies, I don't know, but it's chronic, it's crippling. Now, with your hands raised, lay the palms forward like this to the Lord. Lay like this. Get ready because your hands are going to begin to burn. Like forward. Forward like this. Like this. Like hands. Palms up. Palms up. Say, Father, anoint my hands with healing power. Let them burn. I saw the Lord putting like balls of fire in people's hands for healing. It's almost like he's handing you spirit-filled prescription. And so say, Lord, let my hands burn with a holy fire now. Ha! That happened to me at 16. I'm telling you, it'll do it. Say, burn, burn, Holy Spirit, burn. He's going to give you a cauterizing anointing on your hands. Ha! Karen Sue, join me.
Everlasting joy. There is a joy, everlasting joy, that the world needs to see. Let them see through you.
Right now, Lord, that there is a spirit of freedom in this house tonight. Lord, that there are those who are going to be set free from bondages that have held them captive for decades, that they have been held bondage to things. And Lord, I declare right now that there is freedom in this house in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray that there is a freedom that comes over their minds, that the enemy has tried to silence them, that the enemy has tried to tell them that they are worthless, that they are nothing, that they will never accomplish anything. But I declare tonight in Jesus' name that the lies of the enemy are broken in Jesus' name. Freedom in Jesus' name. Lord, there are those in this room that you want to know that you are silencing the voice of the enemy in their life tonight. The lies that have come in, that have tormented them, that have haunted them, the lies of their past, the lies of the things that they have run away from for so long. Tonight is the night that you are bringing freedom into their lives, healing into their hearts and into their minds. There is healing oil that is flowing tonight, not just for the bodies, but for the mind, for the spirit, for the soul. You are doing it complete. You said you have come to make them whole in Jesus' name. That you have not come to just make them well, but you have come to make them whole by the blood of Jesus Christ. That there are things that they have been holding on to, that they have been clinging to as a crutch that they can always run back to. But you're telling them tonight that you are removing the crutches from their life so that they can mount up with wings and soar with you. Freedom, sweep over them tonight. For those of you who have unsaved loved ones, who have unsaved kids, you may not even know where they're at tonight. You may not know where you, the next time that you'll hear from them. But God says tonight that he is intervening on their behalf. That your prayers have not gone unheard. That your prayers, your tears that have fell to the ground has not gone unseen. That he sees them. He knows where they're at. That he is sending ministering angels to walk around to protect them, to bring them home. That God is doing a work in their lives. That there is being war being done in the heavenlies.
God wants to wake up somebody's finances in here. You've been faithful, but you need a miracle. Who are you? No, I got to be able to hear you, not just see you. I got to hear you. Yeah. I hear you. Say this. Hands raised. Say in Jesus' name. My finances are not mine. I release them to the Lord. I will be obedient. And this day, Father, awaken my bank account. I repent for improper debt. I repent for not being faithful. This day, poverty spirit, you must go. And with your hands raised, and say, Jesus, I will not be lazy. I will be frugal. I will be a giver. I am blessed. I walk in the righteousness of God. He withholds nothing good from me. Lord, you can trust me. Open the windows. Pour out the blessing. Ah. Hey, there's some millionaires in this room. You just don't know it yet. I'm telling you. There's some millionaires in this room. There's millionaires in this room. Oh, you didn't even get excited about that. There's some millionaires. Who am I talking to? Who's the millionaires? You know what? You know what the Lord's going to do? He's going to show your family that you don't have to be broke in the ministry. Your parents, your family got to see that. The Lord's going to use you to show them that you didn't step into a brokenness. Yeah. And I say in the next 6 months, respect will come to your calling from your family. Your family will say, I respect what you stepped into. I didn't until now. I see it. Her family. I don't even know her family, but they're going to see it. 6 months. Mark my words. Come on and praise him.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for the Holy Spirit now. For the Holy Spirit and power. Praise you, Jesus. We praise you, Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for the Holy Spirit. For the Holy Spirit and power. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Father, we thank you for the great shakings of the Holy Ghost in our life. Father, we thank you for the great outpourings of your Spirit that destroys every yoke. Let a flood come through me. Say it. Let a flood come through me. Let your glorious presence pour out of my soul. Let a great flood
come through me. Let a great outpouring of your presence be revealed here in my life. Jesus, Jesus, Kasayato, Kasayato, Kasayato. Just lift those hands towards heaven. Lift your hands towards heaven. Stand in his presence. Stand with a heart wide open, with a spirit and a soul now receiving. Let this glory overwhelm you now. Let this glory take you to the places where only Christ Jesus can raise you up to. Oh, let this faith rise up within you, knowing that what God has spoken, he shall certainly bring to pass. Let a great outpouring of your presence flow through me right now. For the Holy Spirit, for the Holy Spirit and power, for the Holy Spirit, for the Holy Spirit and power. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. For the whole. For the
just join hands with the person close by you? Just everybody get it. You need to have both hands filled with a hand. Make it real simple. That way no one's got one empty hand. So that'll help you figure out what you're supposed to do. Especially for the folks on the end. Now what we're going to do is we know the challenges that we face with respect to bringing the lost in and the people who need a touch from heaven. We understand that. So what we're going to do right now is we're going to agree together in the mighty name of Jesus Christ that the authority of heaven will break off whatever yoke there is with respect to the people that I know that you purposed to bring here tonight and they didn't get here. So we're going to go after this thing together. And, you know, I don't want you bellowing. I want you praying. Okay? A few minutes ago I heard someone just begin to cry out. Boy, I'm telling you, that cry had some power to it. So the reality of it is, if you want to, so to speak, bellow, fine. I just want it to be something that is being ignited within your spirit by the Holy Spirit. That's all. So there is the expression, no limit. You know, just let it be God. But what we're going to do right now is we're going to begin to go to prayer here. Some of you may just begin, and maybe all of you may just begin to pray in the Holy Ghost. Or maybe some of you may begin to just pray in a realm of just thanking God for the anointing that He's given. See, many times we begin to pray prayers of doubt and unbelief. We don't even realize it. Oh, God, when are you going to start doing something? Hey, you know what? That's a prayer of unbelief. Because He's doing a lot. Amen. And so we just begin to have to let the Spirit of the Lord begin to do work through us tonight. But what we're going to do tonight, this night, we're going to break off the authority of hell that would be as mind-blinding spirits. See, the Lord gave, this is the heavenly vision. People got different ideas of heaven vision. But Paul's heavenly vision was just like Jesus. He said, I've been given the power and the authority to turn people from Satan to God. So we're going to activate that here in this place. Now, listen, I want you to allow the anointing that you have received from heaven that I most certainly testify of being in your life. Because I know what can happen in this place tonight. I know that you guys can go to singing and we can go into a whole other dimension of the meeting and it'll be here till 12 or 1 o'clock in the morning. I understand that. And it's not a bad thing because Saturday's tomorrow, you can sleep in. But I want us to effectively join together and I want to see a focus of faith in the anointing to see this place jam-packed with people tomorrow. Because Father gives you an insight and gives you a special anointing of certainty about the people that you talk to. How many of you, I know you raised, you got hands joined. I don't want you to break that adjoinment. But how many of you had people that said they were going to be here tonight and they didn't come? Just those people who had people who... people told you they were going to come, they didn't come. I want you to raise your hand. Just hold it up. Okay? Well, tomorrow night, I want to make sure that everybody in this place, their hand goes up. That you invited someone and they told you they were coming. We're believing God for enough anointing that it captivates. Huh? If you told somebody you were giving out $1 million to everyone who showed up, you'd have a lot of folks come. That would be kind of captivating. They would just show up to see how that's going to work out. And God's given to us a message of something far greater to the human heart than the idea or the prospects of having $1 million. It is the anointing that convinces the heart of that which the mind could never possibly understand. Listen to me. And I'm praying tonight, and you're going to agree with me tonight, and we're going to be empowered tonight. We've been at this a long time. We've seen a lot of things come and go. We've seen a lot of high moments since 19,
especially since 1994 up until this day, 20 years. And it started before that. But I'm telling you, I'm believing God. I'm hooking up with the faith that's going on in Pat and Karen about seeing a shaking come to San Diego. I'm a team player. I'm not this isolated guy saying, you know, God's going to do it all through me and by me. That's nuts. God's brought us together as a family and as a body to now hook up together in agreement for things. And you've been hearing me talk about this. Listen, I'm saying now. I got faith for now. Not tomorrow, not next week, not next month, not next year. And we just want the Spirit of the Lord begin to move in you in the realms of the gift of faith. Without that wonderful working of faith, probably there's no dimension of the gift of the Spirit that will work in your life. That's the way that I believe it to be. And so we're going to begin to agree by the Spirit of the Lord. We're going to begin to pray. And a gift of faith is going to rise up in you. A working of faith is going to begin to rise up in you of authority to lay hold on people and bring them. Now, there's going to come a time in the not-too-distant future that people are going to lay hold on you and say, I heard that the glory of God was in your midst. We want to go where you're going. Okay? But right now, we're going to have to be a little bit more aggressive about it. Hallelujah. Everything that would stand in the way, every power of darkness that would prevent those who would come from coming, every authority of fear, we bind in the name of Jesus. Father, I thank you that every authority of fear, no matter how it would work, either in the hearts of your people or against the minds of your people or against the people that are around about them. In Jesus' name, we break that thing. Father, we praise you for the anointing. Father, we praise you for the great outpourings of the Holy Ghost. Father, we praise you for this authority to set the captives free. Father, we praise you for a mighty wind of revival, a mighty shaking of the Holy Ghost. Father, we praise you for a mighty shaking. Now receive. Receive a great confidence and boldness. Father, right now, by the Holy Spirit, by your glorious work of grace, Holy Spirit, fill us. Fill us with boldness. Fill us, oh God, with the realm of confidence and certainty. Let faith begin to work. Listen, what you're going to do, you're going to compel your loved ones. Some of you have parents that know the Lord, don't know the Lord, doesn't matter. You're going to tell them, you're coming to the meeting. And then if they say no, you're going to get down on your knees and you're going to start crying or something. You're going to say, you're coming to the meeting. Look at here. You're going to do whatever it takes. You'll just go into a prayer meeting right in front of them. That's what I mean about falling down and just praying. I mean, crying in front of them. You're going to bring them. They're going to come. You use whatever means necessary. Hallelujah. You can even pull out, you said you love me, and if you love me, you can see pull that one out. Father's going to begin to lay people on your heart that they said, well, if there was some kind of proof that God exists, maybe I'd believe. And you're going to be able to hook up in faith. You know what? fear begins to work and fight against faith and say, oh no, I'm going to tell them that there's going to be proofs and miracles, and then all of a sudden you come with trepidation and fear, and really what's happening is you're yielding your members to just the opposite of what your members ought to be doing. But no more in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I know many of you are already valiant in these things, but I want every one of you. God wants every one of you to be fully equipped. I'm telling you right now, people are not going to stay outside tomorrow night. I command this place to be filled up. Now, we command in you to do that work. Father has authorized you and given you the authority to tell people what they're going to do with their tomorrow night. Say Pakanaya. And for those of you who have friends and family members, I know there's hundreds of people watching by the web tonight, and you know, if I look at the statistics, I know it's going to be bigger than that. And then I look around here right now, and I see people that belong to this church that are not here tonight. And, you know, they're not going to get a phone call from me because they're watching on the web. I know exactly what you're doing. And you're not allowed to watch on the web. If you are in driving distance, it is forbidden. You get here. Listen, people, this is more than just a meeting. It's a time when we come together and we begin to intercede. We begin to petition God. It ain't a meeting in the sense that we're just coming to an event. It's an opportunity for everybody that is in the place to receive what they have need for. But more than that, it's an opportunity that you and I come into agreement in a place where we stand in expectation for Father to come and just blow the thing up with His glory. Because listen to me. Nothing short of that is going to hold back the darkness. Nothing short of men like Joshua, who can command the moon and the sun to stand still, that there may be more daylight until the work is done. Let this stir in you. Let this stir in you. Let this confidence, let this boldness stir in you. The Holy Spirit's going to give you an ability that you won't find within your own self. The Holy Ghost, let me assure you, the Holy Ghost is going to give you an ability that you cannot find. Though you went on a thorough search of it, you would not discover it within yourself. He wants you to look to Him. He's going to do it. God wants to give you confidence tonight that this is what's going to happen. Things will not remain as they have been because you demand them to change. You demand it to be different. You demand it. I see too many people walking around with a sorrowful heart over lost loved ones and whatnot. You should be walking around with a sorrowful heart over lost loved ones. You should be walking around with a heart full of faith and confidence because you're in charge. And they can run, but they cannot hide. And they can fight, but they will not win. And though they may resist, God the Father and the Holy Ghost are going to team rope them and come bring them in. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Shockwaves of glory. Now, in Jesus' name, faith. The gift of faith. Faith. The working of His mighty power in you. The gift of faith. Just a rabasta. Just receive right now. The gift of past is to pray. The gift of pana. See peninea. That's it. Lenana mane. The rabounde. Yeah, brosa. Yeah. The gift of faith. Sata sereya. The gift of faith. This, the gift of faith, right now in Jesus' name. Holy Spirit, we thank you for your work of love. Fill us now with faith. Fill us now with that divine power and ability to see the change happen now.
Now, where that no man, Lord, will be able to resist our words or the wisdom that you've given us. No one will be able to resist. Satan, I destroy your work right now. I bring down your strongholds of lies now. Your deception no longer can work against those who any person in this place encounters. Jesus, right now, right now, right now, right now. Ha ha. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Now let me tell you what's going to happen. This place is going to be jam-packed with people tomorrow. They're going to be out the door, just like they were in April with Brother Yen. They're going to be out the door. We're going to have to squeeze. We're going to squeeze in here. Might have to move the platform back. Don't look at me like that. That's kind of a wondering eye. That's a wondering eye. Don't give me no wondering eye.